Kiritam Kalmashapalam Shravanamangalam Srimadatatam Udirnandite Puridajana.
Today is the holy day of Swami Premanandaji's Jayanti. Swami Premananda, also called as Baburam Maharaj, he was one of the 16 monastic disciples of Sri Ramakrishna and one of the 5 Ishwara Kotis whom Sri Ramakrishna called as Ishwara Koti. That means these great souls come to the earth without any samskara of their own. They come only to help others. They don't come here and do sadhana for their own sake. They come into this world after doing all the sadhana in their previous births. They come as perfect souls. They act as the missionaries for spreading the message of the Master, and they go back. So Sri Ramakrishna counted among his 16 monastic disciples, 5 of them as the Ishwara Kotis, or the those who took birth as perfect beings. One was Swami Vivekananda, then Brahmananda, Swami Premananda, Swami Yogananda, and another was Niranjanananda. One of the householder disciples he called as Ishwara Koti. So, apart from him, among the 5, Swami Premananda was a very, very illustrious Swami, as we see now when you go through his life. Swami Premananda was born on 10th December 1861 on a Shukla Navami day. That was a Tuesday. And his father was Tarapada Ghosh, and Matangini was his mother. He had 3 brothers. They were 3 brothers and a sister. So eldest one was Krishna Bhavini Devi, who was almost 12 years senior to him. Next was Tulsi Ram, then Baburam Maharaj, then Shanti Mai. So Shanti Ram Ghosh. So 3 brothers and 1 sister. So when he came to Sri Ramakrishna, Sri Ramakrishna immediately told that this boy is born of a part of Radharani. That means he will have the characteristics of Radha. Radha, though she is a Shakti of Sri Krishna, but she is known for her jnana. Radha never shed tears in bhakti. She had such a supreme bhakti, paravakti. She would never shed tears at all. People asked, what is it that people shed so much of tears in bhakti? You never shed any tear at all. Then one of her attendants told, not that she does not shed tears, she shed tears in oceans, but by the time they appear, her jnana dries it away. She feels one with Krishna. Therefore, the jnana dries away all her bhakti tears. So he was called a part of Radharani, and his elder sister was also Krishna Bhavini Devi. She was also called a part of Radharani. That was Sri Ramakrishna's diagnosis of their spiritual status. Then he was born at the village Antpur. I was very recently there in the Antpur village. From the time he was, and now it has become a big town. So a lot of developments have taken place, and our mission also has entered in. So they have started some missionary activities. So during his childhood, when he was 8 years old, when he did not know anything about the world, If anybody talked, usually the elders talk whenever they see a boy. So you will be married to a very nice girl, you will live like a king, all those things they say. If anybody told him anything like that, you will marry a good queen-like girl. No, 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 don't marry me, I will die if you marry me. He used to shout. From that 8th year itself, he was aware of his spiritual mission, for which marriage was not necessary at all. He imagined, later on he used to recollect, that he was meditating in a grove, a garden, where there was a great monk, and that garden was by the side of Ganga. Later on, when he came to Sri Ramakrishna, he recognized his dream vision as all perfectly true. Here was the great monk, the monk of all monks, Paramahamsa, Sri Ramakrishna, and it was a great, beautiful garden of Rani Rasmani, and it was set just on the side of Ganga. So he came to Sri Ramakrishna and saw that his dream was perfectly fulfilled. So he studied in a school called Metropolitan Institution, where Master Mahashaya M used to teach. And there Swami Brahmananda also, at that time called Rakhal. So he was called Baburam. So Baburam and Rakhal, both of them used to study in the same school, Metropolitan School. And M was the teacher. So naturally the influence of M was there. They must have heard about Sri Ramakrishna. So once he came to Dakshineshwar, that was the first meeting. And Sri Ramakrishna, just as soon as he saw him, "Come here, let me see your features." So he called him near, started examining his hands, his face and all that. And then said, "He is born of a part of Radha. His sister Krishna Bhavani also is born of a part of Radha." So after some time, what happened after the first visit, how many days elapsed, we don't know. But when he visited him for the second time, Sri Ramakrishna went on talking from evening, at that which time he went, up to 10 o'clock night. So there is no question about returning home. So Baburam had to sleep there itself in Dakshineshwar. At that time also, he examined his hand and then said, "Good, good. So the features are very good." So after 10 o'clock, when the conversation was over, at about 11 p.m., when all the Baburam and other devotees also, like Ram Dayal, he was another devotee, they had all gone to bed, suddenly Sri Ramakrishna got up from his bed. At 11 p.m., in that Dakshineshwar, dead of night, so he came to Ram Dayal and said, "Do you know Narendra?" He said, "Yes, sir, I know. Can you bring him now?" At 11 o'clock in the night, how to go to Calcutta and how to wake up Narendra at 12 o'clock? Will not people call people mad? But Sri Ramakrishna was not aware. "Please bring Narendra. He is so pure. He is made of Suddha Sattva. I cannot remain without seeing him now. What shall I do now?" He went on weeping to see Narendra. So then Ram Dayal told him, "Sir, it is too late. There is no vehicle to go. And at the dead of night, so he may also not be feeling like coming. As soon as the dawn takes place, I immediately will go and call him." So Sri Ramakrishna went away. Only just for 20 minutes or 30 minutes, again he came back. "Ram Dayal, I cannot sleep without him. I cannot remain without him, without seeing him. Can you not bring him now?" Again he was consoled. Whole night Sri Ramakrishna was weeping for Narendra. Then this Baburam is observing all this. He said, "Who is this Narendra for whom this Paramahamsa is weeping? And he is so unkind. That fellow could have come like me and stayed in the night instead of making Sri Ramakrishna weep." So Baburam had a very deep impression, even after hearing the name of Narendra. Later on, they became very great friends. So during the third visit, Sri Ramakrishna sent Baburam came to him. As soon as he came, Sri Ramakrishna told him, "Oh, go immediately to Panchavati." He said, "What is happening in Panchavati? Where Narendra and others are all there. They are all having a picnic there. They are cooking khichdi and other things, and they are going to eat it. They have got a lot of singing and bhajan. So you also go and join them." Then immediately Baburam went and joined them. Sri Ramakrishna also went there and joined them in the picnic. So the Dakshineshwar days were not just as we imagine, only meditation and japa and austerity. There was picnic also. There was so much of fun and joy, all of a spiritual kind, at the root of which was Sri Ramakrishna. Then Sri Ramakrishna was once in Balaram Bose's house, where Matangini, mother of Baburam, so she was there, and then by that time Baburam has become very intimate with Sri Ramakrishna, and Sri Ramakrishna feels that Baburam must be with him because he wanted someone to assist. So there was no one else, and so he said, he thought that if Baburam is there, Baburam was so pure, so he was the only person who could touch Sri Ramakrishna when he was in Samadhi. Sri Ramakrishna, when he was in Samadhi, he was just like a living God. No one can touch him because nobody had the purity to touch him. He would feel the pain if anybody impure touched him. At that time also, Baburam could touch him. Baburam could hold him without falling. So he thought Baburam would be a good companion. So he wanted to get Baburam from his mother. So he cajoled his mother. "You see, I am in such a state. I require someone to help me. Baburam is the right person. He is so pure. Why don't you give him over to me? So permanently he will be with me and he will assist me. And I will also teach him all spiritual things." And Matangini was a highly spiritual lady. She immediately agreed. "Yes, I am ready. I will leave Baburam for your service entirely. But you must fulfill two promises for me." "What are those promises?" "One is, you must give me pure devotion, Shuddha Bhakti. And second one is, no child of mine should die before my eyes. That means as long as I am alive, all my children should be alive. Only after I die, let them take whatever course they want." And just imagine, the one is giving pure devotion. That any saint can say, "All right, I'll pray for it. Or I can give myself give some devotion." But the next one, that no child of mine dies during my lifetime, who can assure? Which saint can assure? Only that saint who has got the power of Yama himself. Yama cannot touch anyone against the wishes of that saint. Only that avatar purusha, the Lord himself, only he can give the second boon. Sri Ramakrishna said, "I grant," proving to the world that I am that incarnate Brahman itself, under whose orders death moves. Bhayadasya agnistapati, bhayat tapati surya, bhayad agnischa indrascha, mrityurdhavati panchamaha. The mrityu is afraid. He runs when he sees this Brahman. So terror. So that Brahman itself has come as Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna gives her the boon. "All right, none of your children will die as long as you are alive. Yama is warned once and for all. Don't come here as long as Matangani is there." It happened once. Baburam Maharaj became very seriously ill after Sri Ramakrishna passed away. Then all people became very much afraid, apprehensive, that he may give up his body. But Babaram Maharaj assured them, don't worry, my mother is alive. No death can come to me. Mrityu cannot do anything. My mother is alive. And he recovered. So we see that one later. Sri Ramakrishna used to call Baburam, my very dear one, my dear friend, Dardi. Dardi means who feels greatest. Radha was called as Dardi by Krishna. So Sri Ramakrishna used to call Baburam as my Dardi, my very dear friend. Then once Baburam was serving Sri Ramakrishna. While serving, he was a young boy, 18, 19 years old. And he dozed off while massaging his feet. Perhaps he must have felt tired. He kept his head on Sri Ramakrishna's legs and he dozed off and slept off. So Sri Ramakrishna saw that no massage is taking place, no service is taking place. What has happened? Then this boy has dozed off. He got up, he tied up the mosquito net. It was evening. Mosquitoes are terrific in Dakshineshwar. At that time, even now also. So he tied up the mosquito net so that Baburam is not bitten by the mosquitoes. In the meanwhile, Baburam got up. Sir, what are you doing? Don't worry. Go on sleeping. Otherwise, mosquitoes will disturb you in sleep. Everything will be all right. So he put him into the bed, his own bed, and tied up the mosquito net. So much was the intimacy, so much was the intimate love between them. Sri Ramakrishna goes to Balram's house one day in the scorching heat just to meet Baburam. Just as he was weeping for Narendra, this is another edition of weeping for Baburam. So he wanted to meet him. It was scorching sun. That did not matter. He went all the way from Dakshineshwar to Balram's house in Calcutta to meet Baburam. Sri Ramakrishna was telling about Baburam. It seems he saw a vision in which Baburam was standing like a devi. He was wearing all the ornaments of a female goddess. He had all ornaments, necklace and all. And he had his female attendants also around him. So, confirming his idea that he belonged to Radha. He was a part of Radha. Sri Ramakrishna says, he used to tell others that Baburam does not require any teaching now at all. He has received all spiritual instructions in his dream itself. He requires very little now to be told to make him perfect. He was a near perfect soul. Baburam once begged Sri Ramakrishna to give him vision of God with forms. That's called Bhava Samadhi. So he begged him for giving him Bhava Samadhi. Let me see gods and goddesses in my vision. What could Sri Ramakrishna do? Sri Ramakrishna went to Holy Divine Mother Kali and then told Baburam wants to see the vision of gods and goddesses. Please give him Bhava Samadhi. Immediately Mother said, no, he will not get Bhava Samadhi. Instead he will get Jnana. He will see that himself is the pure soul, ever omnipotent, omnipresent soul, and is different from his body, from the world, from everything. So he will get this jnana. So Mother, instead of giving him bhakti, which is bhava, bhava samadhi, she gave him jnana. So Sri Ramakrishna was piqued. He said, in one of the statements that is recorded in M's gospel, so gospel writes, Sri Ramakrishna is talking to Holy Sri Divine Mother. Mother, the other day I asked you to give Bhava Samadhi, that is bhakti, to Baburam. You did not do. You said you will give him jnana. All right, you have your own way. So, it was true that Mother had her own way. Our Mother must have thought, he is already bhakti. He is born as a part of Radha. Let me make him more complete. Jnana also, as Swami Vivekananda was perfect both in jnana and bhakti. When he was a bhakta, he was bhakta to the extreme. When he was jnani to the extreme. When he was yogi to the extreme. Karmi, karmi to the extreme. So Sri Ramakrishna was making him more perfect. And he got jnana instead of bhakti. Then one day, this Babaram and Rakal and Narendranath also, they used to go and talk with that Hazra, who is the clown of this drama of Sri Ramakrishna. So this Hazara was sitting. So Hazara told Babaram, "Hey Babaram, you are coming here just talking to Sri Ramakrishna and going and taking part in picnic, etc. and going away. Ask for the Ashta Siddhis, all the powers, the Anima, Garima, Angulya, Chandra Sparshanam, all these things, 8 Siddhis are there, yogic Siddhis. So why don't you ask for them? You can easily get it." When he was talking like this, then Sri Ramakrishna overheard this. Immediately he called Babaram, called him, and then said, "What did Hazara tell you?" He told Hazara was asking me to beg of you the Ashta Siddhis. Then Sri Ramakrishna told him, "Don't be a beggar. Why should you beg from father whose wealth is only meant for the son? You don't have to beg your father for your money. It is yours. Whatever father has is yours." So Sri Ramakrishna said, "Don't be a beggar. All I have is yours only. You only have to know you are my children. I am your father. This is all you have to know." Later on he used to tell all the devotees also, "Those that are intimately with me, they all need to have know 2 things only. They don't have to know many things. They should know who they are. That means they are all divine people who have come to assist me in my Leela. Second, who I am. That means I am their eternal guru. I am their eternal father and mother. I am the incarnation of God. These only 2 things. They should know who they are. They should know who I am. And what is our relationship. If these 2 they know, they don't have to do anything. Who will do anything? When once we know that God is our own father and mother, we need not do anything. He will take care of everything. Sri Ramakrishna, one night, he got up in the dead of night and moving about in his room, spitting spittle all over. Thoo, 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 like that. So, Babaram could not understand. Later on, he explained it. Perhaps, Divine Mother was testing him by giving him the Ashta Siddhi, etc., name, fame, etc. Sri Ramakrishna was so much disgusted. He was actually spitting inside his own room. I don't want these powers. I don't want this name. I don't want this fame. Such was his vairagya. Even in his dream, he could not accept anything. Then, Babaram was a student, as we have known. He could not study. Naturally, coming to see Ramakrishna and asking for Bhava Samadhi and engaging himself in spiritual practices, he neglected his studies. So he failed in his university entrance test. Class 12 says, class 12 as we call it today. So when he failed, he came to Sri Ramakrishna and Sri Ramakrishna heard that he had failed. Anybody would have felt sorry. "I am sorry you failed because you did not prepare, because you devoted much of your time for your spiritual practice." Some condolence they would have given. Sri Ramakrishna, on the contrary, he expressed his joy. "Very good. You have failed. You have failed. That is very good. The people who have passed, all those peoples, they have got so many passes. All the passes are pashas. Pasha is bondage. Passing degrees. Each degree is a bondage. It is true. Swami Vivekananda also referred to degrees. The degrees, instead of giving knowledge, it is giving vanity. But more you see, nowadays you see the people who are having degrees, they have forgotten all about the knowledge they have studied. Only about the vanity. "I have got 3 degrees. I have got 4 degrees. What about your study? You let me know." They have forgotten everything. only vanity. So give knowledge to the ignorant, give more knowledge to the educated, because the vanity is terrific with them. That was Swamiji's words. So Sri Ramakrishna told him, so many passes, so many pashas, so many degrees, so many bondages. You got rid of one degree and the bondage also. Be happy. Jarjo to pash, tarto to pash. To pass and pash, he alliterated. Then, in 1886, August 16, Mahasamadhi of Sri Ramakrishna. Then, Baburam assumed the name Premananda by becoming a monk along with Rakal, Naren and others. In 1887, he goes on a long pilgrimage to Kashi, Vrindavan and all those places and comes back to Jayarambati. So, when he came to Jayarambati, he saw, even while he was entering, there was a big tank full of lotuses. So he just jumped into the tank, went on collecting 108 lotuses. What for? To worship Holy Mother's feet. 108 lotuses. That was the devotion. What would happen? What is there in that dirty water? He did not bother. He was bothered about collecting lotuses and worshipping Mother. So he picked up 108 lotuses. When he comes out with 108 lotuses, big bundle, his whole body is full of blood. So many leeches have got. One leech is enough to bleed you out. Sir, dozens of leeches have caught. Whole body was full of blood. He was not aware at all. Somehow he was rescued from all that. Then he came and then worshipped Mother. Mother was also, was not at all happy. Such, why do you do such things? You should do it. You must have some tact. You must have intelligence in doing all these things. She scolded him also. Then, in 1897, Swami Vivekananda returned from the West. At that time, then Premananda was also in Calcutta. Then afterward, he left for... Swami Vivekananda came. Then after, as soon as he came, he saw number of young people have joined the Ramakrishna Mutt. So he made certain rules. One of the rules was, everybody must get up early, say at 3:30 in the morning, and come to the shrine and meditate. So one day, Baburam was late. He must have been meditating all through in the night. So he must have just gone to rest at that time. He did not come. But that was late in any way. So he himself went to Narendra and then confessed to him. You see, I have come late. Give me punishment. Then Narendra was astonished. Do you think, Baburam, that I will be able to punish you? Then Narendra started shedding tears. Then Baburam also started shedding tears. So one has to punish, one has to take the punishment. Both of them are not willing to do. He is not ready to give the punishment. He is not does not want to give up the punishment. So he wants to take the punishment. Then Brahmananda Swami comes as the arbiter. Then he said, all right, he need not do much punishment. He need not take. Let him go and collect Madhukari Bhiksha. Madhukari means going to 4 or 5 houses and collecting baked food and bringing it and eating in the... Let Baburam do that. So Baburam did that one. So that incident closed like that. Then he, as the manager, he used to tell all the brahmacharis, study and serve also. So you have to do the service. Lot of work is there in the mutt mission. Now we have some servants here. At that time, no servants. All the 25 acres of land had to be kept clean, every inch of it. So all had to be done by the brahmacharis. Gardening is to be done, kitchen garden, flower garden, then helping the kitchen, helping the temple, puja, worship, then cooking. Everything had to be done by this brahmachari. But it should not be only work and work. So manager, as manager, Bhavana means to say, you must study also. At the same time, you must do service also. Both must go on. Spiritual practices, of course, it is there. Do Swamiji's work, he used to tell. Then you will be able to meditate on Sri Ramakrishna. Some of them had difficulty in meditating on Sri Ramakrishna. How to improve your meditation? He said, do Swamiji's work, thinking that Swamiji's work is the work of Sri Ramakrishna himself. When you do this work, your mind will be freed from all distractions. With distractionless mind, you will be able to meditate on Sri Ramakrishna. So, once Bhavaram Maharaj was invited to Malda. At that time he was staying with Holy Mother. So he had so much of love. This Malda visit was a different one. He was invited to Malda. He went to Malda, is a place nearby Calcutta. So he went there and lectured. So as he was lecturing, someone in the lecture got up and then said, you are talking about Karma Yoga and all that. We want to hear about Shuddha Bhakti, pure love, Radha's love. You please let us know. Then this Bhavaram Maharaj immediately replied him, give me your severed head, then only I can tell you what pure love is. Head means the ego. Unless the full ego goes, you cannot understand what pure love is. Pure love, one forgets one's own body, the whole world. The pure love of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he mistook Yamuna for the sea. Sea for the Yamuna, jumped into sea. He had to be fished out and brought. This is pure love. Any little ego, you cannot get pure love. So Babaram told him, give me your severed head, cut your head off, give it to me, I will let you know immediately about pure love. I will teach you pure love. First do the Karma Yoga according to Swami Vivekananda. Then you will get real bhakti, prema, everything, he taught. Then he went to Devbhog, Nagmahashya's birthplace. There, Swami Brahmananji was also there. Then there were a lot of devotees. There was kirtan. There was a great spiritual emotion. Then Brahmananda Swami got up, started dancing. Then Premananji also got up. Both of them started dancing. Dancing, they went into an ecstatic state. Both of them went into samadhi. They stood motionless. It was a sight for gods to see. So, and as the manager of the Belur Math, lot of young people used to come from different places, mostly from Calcutta. And in Calcutta there were so many young people who were otherwise very promising, but they had become addicted to ganja, to drinks and all that. So one boy was a very good boy. He had been spoiled like that. He had got addicted to ganja and alcoholic drinks. Though these people could not cure him in any way. So they brought him to Bhavaram Maharaj. They were not sure whether Bhavaram would take the responsibility of this boy. Bhavaram said, all right, you leave him with me. He kept him with him for some time. A few days staying with Bhavaram Maharaj, this boy overcame the ganja addiction, he overcame the alcoholic addiction, all addictions left him. His real spiritual nature started asserting and he became a monk of the order. That was the tremendous spiritual personality that Swami Premananda was. And he would also scold many times, but his scolding would be very sweet. People would never be hurt at all. So, once, you see, one brahmachari was serving khichdi to the poor people. The poor people were so hungry. This brahmachari, as usual, so he was serving just like as he would be serving the city people. But these tribals and other people who were eating, they were different type. They could eat 10 times than a city person would do. Even you can compare yourself with the rural people. Go to the rural people. How much of rice they can take? 1 kg of rice, 4 people can finish off. Whereas here 100 people also, these towns people cannot eat. One kg of rice. They are used to it. So this brahmachari was serving little by little this khichdi. They were seeking, hey, give more khichdi, give more khichdi. When Babaram heard, hey, brahmachari, you take one balti. Balti means the bucket. Bucket full of khichdi means pongal. Loose pongal. You pour the whole khichdi on their plates. That is how we should serve. So the brahmachari did it. So all the poor people were very happy. So then Babaram visits Puri. So in Puri when he went, he had a very wonderful darshan of Jagannath. At the same time, when he came out to the temple, he sees a Christian missionary. He was preaching Christ. Naturally, when they preach Christ and Christianity, they were deprecating and depreciating the values of Hindus and Hinduism. Then Babaram got hurt. What is this? He is preaching against Hinduism. He went into that congregation, big congregation. He started shouting, all say, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. When he started shouting Hari Bol, the whole lot started saying Hari Bol, because they were all Hindus only. So Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Krishna's name they started singing. The whole Christian missionary meeting got dispersed. So the Christian missionary got very much hurt. He left the place. So that day went off. So when Babaram was about to sleep, Sri Ramakrishna appeared to him in a vision. He said, what did you do in the evening? You went and disturbed the meeting of that missionary. He was preaching Christ. What was wrong there? I am Christ. He was preaching my name. So why did you go and disturb him? Go tomorrow morning and apologize. So Sri Ramakrishna was real Christ. That is why he said he was preaching my name. You went and disturbed. So go tomorrow morning, search out that missionary, apologize to him and come, which Babaram did. This was Sri Ramakrishna's harmony of religions. Not only he did not want Hindus to become Christian, he did not want Christians to be disturbed also by the Hindus. Let them follow their own religion. Babaram did not take fish. He was a Vaishnava. Therefore, he did not take fish. Not only he did not like others were taking fish. That is the problem. You need not take fish. But if somebody takes, why should you bother about it? But he did not like. But that was a blemish. Sri Ramakrishna appeared to him in a vision and then said, you are not taking fish. Do you think you achieved everything? Immediately Babaram fell at his feet. No sir, I am sorry. He went and from the prasad dish, he took a little fish, put it into his mouth so that his ego will never more be there, that I am superior to a person who is taking fish. Babaram, he was a very highly kind-hearted person. So when there was a theft in the Belur Mutt, a barber came, he stole something, and then the police caught him. So when the police brought him there, then Babaram Maharaj said, no, he did not steal. I was about to give him something, so I was searching for him. So you leave him off, he is not a thief. Then he gave him a new cloth and some money also and told all the brahmacharis around, saying, you see, if one is very, very poor, one's good nature goes away. Even good people become bad when they are affected by severe poverty. That is what has made this man steal. He is not a thief by himself. Poverty has made him a thief. That may be true of more than 90% of thieves. Then Babaram and Holy Mother, they had a special love for each other. Babaram would go into ecstasy by hearing the name of Holy Mother. Holy Mother also would go into ecstasy. So once some people from the same Malda where he had gone earlier, they all came. So they invited him. So you must come and attend our Jayanti celebrations there. Then Holy Mother, seeing the frail health of Babaram Maharaj, said, no, you have got frail health, don't go. Immediately Babaram Maharaj said, Holy Mother said, no, I will not come. So these people thought, what is this? We are inviting for Sri Ramakrishna Jayanti, and Malda is not very far, hardly 5-6 hours journey. So we will take him by car, we will bring him back by car. We will take all care of him. But he said, no, Holy Mother has said, no, I will not go. They all went and caught hold of Holy Mother. Mother, we will promise you, we will take every care. Please allow him to go. Then, after hearing all their pleas, then Holy Mother relented. She called Babaram. Babaram, you can go. Yes, immediately he became ready. He followed them, went and attended the function and came. Just like a child, he is a paramahamsa of the highest order. So, but before Mother, he was just like a child. With Swami Brahmananda also, it was like that. So, Brahmananda, they had a great love between one another. But once, a small altercation happened. And what was that? There was a pumpkin in the mud kitchen garden. So the pumpkin, several pumpkins were there. So Babaram had marked the first pumpkin that appeared to be given to Thakur, Sri Ramakrishna. And there were other pumpkins also. Then he thought, some great devotee who was helping the mutt so much, he thought, let me give one pumpkin to him. He took out one pumpkin and then gave it to the devotee. But somehow or other, some brahmacharis went and reported this one to Swami Brahmananji. Brahmananji was the president. So Brahmananji said, what? From mutt kitchen garden, why should the pumpkin to be given away to somebody outside? He may be a devotee, but this pumpkin, this is to be given to Thakur only. After as prasad, it can be given to others. How can pumpkin be given? Call Babaram. So he took him to task. So Babaram could not stand that. He said, what? I am the manager here. I cannot give one pumpkin from here out of so many pumpkins. That also to a devotee whom everyone knows. So he was so much piqued. Let me leave this mutt and go away. Go away means he can go and anywhere he can drown himself in spiritual practices. So with this decision, he left the mutt, left the presence of Brahmananda Swami, was going towards the main gate. Just as he approached the main gate, he found Sri Ramakrishna was standing there. In a vision, Sri Ramakrishna is standing there. He took out the Angavastra, which he was wearing. He put it round the neck of Babaram and caught hold of him. Where will you go, my dear? This is my place. And you leave me and go. Come back. He drew him inside the mutt and left him in the center of the mutt. Then he came to know that his whole mutt and Brahmanandaji himself, they were all part and parcel of Sri Ramakrishna. So from that time onwards, no more altercation happened like that. So Swami Brahmananda Swami, once he left Belur Mutt. He went away and he was staying in Banaras for some time. Then Babaram Maharaj could not bear the absence of Brahmananji. He went to Banaras. He requested Brahmananji to come back. The mutt looks very, very envy. It becomes, without you, it looks very dry. You come back. Instead of coming with him, he went away to Allahabad. So he was staying in Allahabad. Then he followed him to Allahabad. He fell at the feet of Brahmananda Swami. Brahmananda Swami, you must come. You must come with me. Otherwise, I will not return to Mutt. If the manager does not return, and if the president also is there, what will happen to the Mutt? Then Brahma says, all right, I will accompany you. So he brought him back. So, once this incident, which I told you earlier, Premananda was affected with cholera. He went into delirium. All people were alarmed that he may give up his body. But as soon as he came back to consciousness, he said, "Don't worry, no cholera can kill me. Mother is alive." So Sri Ramakrishna has granted her the boon that when she is alive, nobody can die. And later on, he recovered and came out of the crisis. Then he visited Bangladesh, where he taught them all the karma yoga by himself cleaning up the whole big tanks full of scum and other things. And he had to suffer also. He was affected with Kala Azar. Kala Azar was an incurable disease at that time. He was affected with Kala Azar and he was also affected with influenza. He came back to the Mutt, and so in the influenza plus Kala Azar made him very serious. It was 1918. So when he came back, he was immediately sent to the doctor and the treatment was given. But he would not recover. He went back into delirium. So he started telling, "I feel like dressing myself in a yellow robe and eat the white rice." Both were the desires of Radharani recorded in the scriptures. So he was feeling that he was one with Radharani. Then Swami Brahmananji asked him, "Do you remember Thakur Baburam?" He said, yes, very much, by his grace, he told. And he left the body on 30th July 1918. He was hardly 57 years at that time. Then when the Holy Mother heard about Baburam's passing away in Belur Mutt, she was so much overwhelmed. She started telling, "Baburam was the Shakti." That means he was the power in the Mutt. He was the Yukti. He was the intelligence in the Mutt. And Bhakti also. He was devotion. He was Shakti, Yukti and Bhakti personified. And he was living in Belur Mutt, illumining the whole Belur Mutt. So that was Swami Premananji. And Premananji's touch, we have already seen. An addict had come out of his all addiction and became a monk. There was another case, the case of Swami Akhilanandaji, who taught Vedanta in America for almost 60 years. Akhilanandaji was known as one of the great psychoanalysts also. He had met the great psychoanalysts of his time. And this, later on, this great missionary of Sri Ramakrishna, he also as a young man, he came to Swami Premanandaji. So they were all indulging in the freedom movement. So he met Premanandaji and told Premanandaji, "Sir, Swami Vivekananda wanted all of us to take part in this political movement. That is what we're all doing." Then Premanandaji told, "No, sir, Swami. Swamiji wanted all of you must become spiritual. And after becoming spiritual, you can do whatever you want." But he said, "Sir, you don't understand. He wanted us to work for the country first." Then Premanandaji got upset. He said, "What? We have been living with Swamiji day and night for years together, and we don't understand Swamiji, and you have understood. You are like a horse. Your brain is like a horse's brain. Come, bow down like a horse." Then he was made to stand on his fours. Then Baburam Maharaj climbed up on his back. "Take me round his room." So this young man took him round the room. Then Baburam Maharaj came down. And Akhilanji writes later on that one touch had done the miracle. Very next day onwards, he lost all interest in political movement and came and became a brahmachari, then became a great Swami who preached Vedanta in the West. Swami Brahmananji said, one Swami Brahmananji was staying in Puri. So one Swami, young Swami from Belurmat, went to Puri. Then as soon as he went to Puri, he went away to his room. Then he went to darshan of Jagannath. In the evening only he went to Swami Brahmananji. He was also staying in, Brahmananji was staying in Puri. In the evening he went and told, "Sir, Swami Premananji told me to tell his respects to you." "What? Swami Premananji told you yesterday night when you started by the train, and you came in the morning and in the evening you are coming to me and telling what Babu Ram has told you. Do you know what Babu Ram is?" "Babu Ram is like a purity personified, such holiness, such purity. As long as his eye vision falls, that whole direction will become pure. Everyone will become pure. Such a great saint, he has told you to tell something to me and you have delayed by 12 hours like this. Be careful when such great people are there. You must immediately carry their message and do whatever they say." That was the great respect Swami Brahmananji had. So like this, Swami Premananji was a star of the first order among the very direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. So such a great person has lived and sanctified the Sangha, and he has imbued his power into the Sangha, which will go for next 1500 years. So we are fortunate to have just gone through some of the important incidents of his life. May we pray to Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swamiji and Premananda also to bless us all, so that we can also imbibe their spirit and make our lives blessed.
Niranjanam nityam anantarupam bhaktanukampadrita vigraham vai ishavataram parameshamidyam tam ramakrishnam shirasanamamah.